Good
Okay,
evening,
good.
sir.
Preeti, you can start, ma'am.
Yes, sir. Good evening, sir. I'm Dr. Preeti Subbalakshmi, second year
Can she
DNB
start,
resident.
sir? Rajupala, can she?
I'm sir.
Please go ahead.
Sir, good evening, one and all, sir. I'm Dr. Preeti Subbalakshmi from St. Isabel Hospital. My guide is Dr. Kanagwal, sir. I'm grateful to sir for giving me this opportunity to present in this forum. Shall I start, sir?
Please, ma'am.
Please.
A 63-year-old gentleman who is a retired government employee coming from Mylapore, Chennai, presented with chief complaints of swelling below the right ear for past 1 month and pain in the swelling while chewing food for past 5 days. A present history, as stated by the patient, he was apparently asymptomatic a month ago, following which he had noticed a small swelling below and behind the right ear lobule, which was insidious in onset, has progressed to present size, which is double the size of what he had noticed in the beginning. He also gives the history of pain for past 5 days over the swelling, which is intermittent, dull aching in character, low in intensity, present only during mastication, not radiating type of pain, and
there is
no history of
change. Preeti, please unmute yourself. Yeah.
There is no history of
please
change
go
in
ahead.
Size. There is no history of change in size of the swelling while chewing. No history of fever. No history of sudden increase in size of the swelling. No history of swelling on the contralateral side or swelling in the neck or scalp or anywhere else in the body. There is no history. The next slide, please.
Yeah, I know.
No history of dryness of mouth, no history of dysphagia, no history of trismus, no history of weight loss, and no history suggestive of facial nerve involvement. Medical history. He is a diabetic, hypertensive, and a known case of coronary artery disease since 2003. He is on medications for that. Past history, he had a left parotid swelling associated with fever, probably mumps, at the age of 50 years, which was treated conservatively. Other details are not known. Surgical history, no history of any major surgery in recent past or surgeries in the region of parotid. Personal history, he takes a mixed diet. He is a non-smoker, non-alcoholic, pan-chewer for 27 years, and he has been abstinent since 2014. His sleep and appetite are apparently normal. Bowel and bladder habits are apparently normal. Family history, there is no history of head and neck cancers running in the family. Summarizing my history, 63-year-old gentleman came with complaints of swelling behind and in front of the right ear for 1 month with history of pain in the swelling while chewing, food for 5 days with no history of recent onset fever, sudden increase in size of the swelling. Patient does not have any history suggestive of facial nerve involvement.
Sir, I had a phone call, sir. I got disturbed. Am I correct, sir?
No problem, sir. No problem.
Now you
try to
wait to happen.
Sir.
No, wait. Just go back to the first slide. Srihari sir, Rajgopal sir, please take over, sir.
Dr. Preeti?
Yes, sir.
So, this is a good presentation for the time being. The main complaint of this patient is swelling below the right ear, 1 month duration.
Sir.
Whenever a patient tells you that swelling below the right ear, 1 month duration, what are the, in a 63-year-old man, what are the one or two things come to your mind at this stage? First visit. We are not even talk to the patient. He shows you, I have got something here. What are the few things come into your mind? First question.
A lymph node, sir.
Very good. And? And this patient is swelling below the right ear, 1 month duration.
Malignant.
Whenever the patient tells you that swelling below the right ear, 1 month duration,
yes.
What are the
yes, sir.
In a 60 there are some problems, sir. Actually, I am not speaking. It is voice is coming repeatedly. I asked her questions. First question is, Kanakwell, you can hear me now.
Sir, we are able to hear.
What are the workouts come to your mind at this stage? This is actually old recording. Old one is coming.
Priti, are you able to hear, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Lymph. Repeatedly, I'm hearing the question, sir.
We are not even talking to the patient.
You said lymph node, ma. Sir is asking, are you able to hear me, Priti?
Ah, yes, sir. I'm able to hear you, sir. But Shenoy sir's question is keep on repeating, sir, 4-5 times.
He asked, what is your thing? You said lymph node, correct.
Yes, sir. Malignant.
What are the other things you think of when they're swelling in below the right ear? What are the other things which come into your mind with these two points, why do you think?
At the age of 63, lymph node, malignancies.
Malignancy, is it primary or secondary?
Primary, sir.
Primary means what is that, Dr. Priti? Primary means?
Swelling arising from the parotid gland.
No.
You said lymph node. That is what I am asking. Is it primary lymph node malignancy or is secondary? Usually, lymph nodes above the clavicle, secondaries are common or primary is common?
Secondaries are more common, sir.
Yeah, now answer Professor's next question. What do you think the next will be? Next, what is the possibility of the next one?
A swelling arising from the parotid gland, sir.
So, to be specific, any specific part of the parotid would you like to mention now?
Tail of the parotid.
Very good. You are a postgraduate. So, as a examiners, you are going to tell, sir, the 63-year-old gentleman has come with the swelling below the right ear for 1 month duration. Keeping that in mind, short duration. So, I would like to consider maybe one is a lymph node metastasis of unknown origin or whatever it is. One. Second possibility, you mentioned about tail of the parotid. Anything else come into your mind? Now you need to imagine the area and think anatomically what structures come in that area. Anatomically, what structures roughly will come there? Yes, try.
A swelling arising from the sternomastoid.
Have you seen a case of any sternomastoid tumor or a sternomastoid swelling?
No, sir.
So unlikely. At least I would have been happy if you say posterior triangle. See, it's below the ear lobule. Below. Below can be both anterior and posterior. Right?
Yes, sir.
So it could be a neural tumors, nerve tumors. You know the posterior triangle is rich in nerves, correct? Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
What nerves come there? Posterior triangle. Simple question.
Sir, accessories, fine.
Okay, fine. Say brachial plexus. You know the most important. Posterior triangle, any firm to heart swelling, one other diagnosis is always a nerve tumors. Okay. So your answer should be, sir, it could be a lymph nodal swelling, number one, most common. Number two, because of the location, I would like to consider it is more towards the ear. So maybe the parotid. And third is, sir, it could be anything else, soft tissue tumor. Because of the age, he's 63. Remember, this is the first impression starting itself. That means you have these three in mind. Then you ask the other questions.
Okay, sir.
Okay, please, sir. Sihari, sir. Please take over, sir.
Yeah, sir. Pain in the swelling while chewing food. What does that indicate to you?
Nerve infiltration, sir.
Common one, you think?
Salivary colics.
Salivary colics. Is it common in the parotid or is it common in any other gland?
It is common in, it is not common in parotid, it is common in submandibular salivary glands, sir.
The reason being,
The reason is submandibular salivary gland, the secretions are more thick and mucus, mucoid and viscous, and the drainage is non-dependent, and also due to the long curved course of the submandibular duct.
What is the duct named as?
Wharton's duct.
Where does it open?
Floor of the mouth, sir.
Shall we go to the next slide, sir?
Yeah, so adding on to all the reasons which you have given, just one important point, the duct is kinked by lingual nerve. Okay, there's a kinking takes place. Yes, so that is why, and calcium is rich. Contents of the submandibular gland, calcium rich. So patient complains of swelling in that area of 1 month duration, and it has progressed to the present size. That is the only thing which you have told me. So you need to mention, is it a rapidly growing swelling? You are not mentioned anywhere.
Yes, sir.
Please tell.
It is a rapidly growing swelling which doubled the size of what he had noticed in the beginning, sir.
So why it is important?
Benign tumors will grow over a long period of time, whereas any malignant tumor will have a short duration of progression.
What is the age of the patient?
63, sir.
So what I'm trying to impress upon you, every stage you need to take the clue. 63, 1 month duration, male, now double the size in short duration. So this is how you start analyzing the cases. Okay. Srihari, sir.
Okay, sir.
Questions, sir? Sir?
Sir, it's going on well, sir. Carry on. Please go ahead.
We have Dr. Kanna, sir, also joined. Sanjay, sir, do you have any questions, sir?
Dr. Subbalakshmi.
Yes, sir.
Patient gives history of pain over the swelling, right? Now tell me quickly, what are the common causes of pain over the swelling? General causes. First, let us talk about general causes. Tell me.
Abscess.
So, abscess.
Inflammatory.
Yes. So, is it inflammatory, yes, look like for you?
No, sir.
Why not?
The patient did not give the history of fever, sir.
That's all. Simple. So, no history of fever. Okay. What are the other causes of pain over the swelling? Come on, try. Simple question.
In this acute bacterial sialadenitis.
So you mean, inflammatory sialadenitis. Very good. You said mumps peritonitis he had. He might have had some kind of fibrosis there. Might have caused some ache. Fine, good. Inflammatory, bacterial, viral, over. Next, anything else?
Nerve, infiltration into the...
So infiltration
of tumor into the nerve.
Either skin itself, infiltration to the skin itself can cause pain. Infiltration to the motor nerves, sensory nerves, depends upon the location of the swelling, and infiltration to the bone. Not in this patient, but this is what examiners ask you. Patient complains of pain over the swelling of 5 days duration, dull aching nature, low intensity. Now present only during mastication. That is what you have written there. Correct? So what may be the reason for that?
Involvement of capsule of the temporomandibular joint.
Where is the swelling?
Below, behind, and just anterior to the
ear lobule. Where is the temporomandibular joint? It is from Kanyakumari to Kashmir, so far away. So?
Sir, capsule... stretching of the parotid capsule causing...
Madam, then the tumor is rapidly growing. There may be a partial compression to the duct. Okay?
Okay, sir.
So what will happen then? What will happen? What will happen?
During mastication, there will be retention of saliva in the gland.
The explanation gets relieved on its own means what? Slowly, once it stops eating, slowly, slowly, it may settle down. It is not a serious matter. That is what you try to analyze like that. Okay?
Okay, sir.
No issue of sudden increase in the size of the swelling. Can you tell me few reasons for a sudden enlargement of the swelling? General. Few reasons. Not only parotid. Go ahead.
Inflammatory.
Very good.
Hemorrhage in thyroid.
Very good. Hemorrhage in thyroid swelling, inflammatory, ovarian cyst, you can have a hemorrhage. Sudden increase in the size of the swelling. Right? Inflammatory pathology. Or even a very rapidly growing tumors. Right? Pulsatile secondaries of the... You heard of thyroid malignancy follicular with the pulsatile secondary in the skull?
Secondaries in the skull, yes, sir.
They go sometimes very fast. Sir, Srinivasan, sir, somebody else can take over, sir. Examiners.
Again, as joints. Professor, sir, Karnagaran, sir. Hello.
No,
sir.
Now, sir.
Karnasar, sir. Karnasar, please. So can we go to the next place, sir?
Why did you ask no history of swelling in the contralateral side, Preeti?
There are few parotid swellings that can occur in both sides.
Very good. Yes, what are they?
Autoimmune diseases like Sjögren syndromes, Mucolik's disease, tumors like Warden's tumor, inflammatory conditions like mumps parotitis can occur bilaterally.
So you would like to rule out a bilateral disease, especially in case of salivary gland, whenever is given to you in the exam. Don't forget autoimmune etiology, especially in a woman. Always remember, whenever a salivary gland is so autoimmune pathology. So you want to rule out a swelling. Why did you ask history of swelling in the skull?
Sir, lymph nodal swelling.
Scalp. You get scalp lymph node here?
Nerve sheath tumors can...
No. Just hold on. I asked you, no history of swelling in the scalp or anywhere you are written. So I just wanted to know about that. Your answer should be, sir, scalp could be the site of primary and what you are getting could be the secondary here. This area of the scalp can drain to posterior triangle nodes, epithelioma, carcinoma, anything, lesion from the scalp. Is it clear? So no issue of swelling in the neck. This is a swelling in the neck only. No other swellings in the neck. No issue of any ulcers over the scalp. These are the draining sites. No other.
What is the chronic cause of bilateral swelling?
Sir, I'm not able to hear the question.
I was asking, what is the commonest cause of bilateral parotid swelling?
Mumps parotitis.
Mumps is not very common cause. Mumps will only occur in children.
Sjögren syndrome.
No, that is so rare.
Alcoholism, diabetes mellitus.
Hardly heard about that.
HIV, lymphoma.
The commonest cause is when the patient is in the ICU or he is on the bed.
Chronic bedridden patients who lack poor oral hygiene are at the risk of developing acute bacterial sialadenitis, sir.
Yes, so that's the bilateral parotitis.
Yes, sir.
So the patient is a sick patient whose oral cavity is dry, he's having high fever in the ICU. That is the commonest cause of the bilateral swelling of the parotid. Yes. What are the bilateral tumors of the parotid?
Warden's tumor.
Warden's tumors, yes.
Acinic cell.
Maybe sometimes, yes.
Oxyphilic carcinoma.
tell any other tumor, which is a real bilateral tumor.
Sir?
You said Waldman's tumor, that is accepted.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, second one, what is the second one? Look at the lymphoma.
Lymphoma, okay.
Okay, lymphoma, the parotid will be the bilateral tumor. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Okay. Go ahead, yeah. You finished your history?
I finished, sir.
Okay.
Dr. Preeti, why did you ask history of dysphagia?
Sir, in case of a deep lobe involvement of parotid, patient will have dysphagia, sir.
And any other reasons why you ask history of dysphagia? See, at this juncture, as I have already told you, you don't think it is parotid. So I told you, you are also thinking in terms of a lymph node. Suppose your patient complains of dysphagia. If it is a lymph nodal swelling,
okay,
where could be the primary? You understood my question? Simple question. Could
oral
be?
Oral cavity.
PG means oral cavity is not the answer.
Buccal mucus.
So what I have, dysphagia, no? So either tongue or oropharynx. Go behind. That's what we want. No history of dysphagia, no history of dryness. Trismus, why trismus?
In case of inflammation, patient will have a painful restricted mouth opening, sir.
Because you said inflammation, I would like to ask you, because now you are giving me chance to ask, what are the inflammatory causes for trismus? What are the inflammatory causes of trismus?
Quincy.
Pharyngitis. Quincy. Paratonsillar abscess, right? All that can give rise to inflammatory causes. Any disease can give rise to trismus, lockjaw. Key has been given to you. Lockjaw. You can't open your mouth only, trismus. See, because you mentioned trismus, I am asking you. Heard of tetanus? Probably your generation might not have seen. So you need to know, because you mentioned that trismus, answer expected was not in the neck. If there's a large mass here, big one, rapidly growing parotid, may infiltrate the masseter, even TM joint, etc., very advanced. Okay. So when you write that trismus, get ready to face all these questions, including submucous fibrosis, all that causes trismus, right? Sir, please take over, sir. Dr. Karunakaran, Kanna, sir.
How will you take the history of the patient involvement?
Yes, please.
A difficulty in closure of eyelids, drooling of saliva, and deviation of angle of mouth.
Apart from the drooling of the saliva, what the patient will complain when he is eating the food?
He or she may not be able to swallow the food, sir. Stasis of food in the vestibule of the mouth.
Yeah, he will be not able to clear the vestibule.
Clear the vestibule.
Yeah, that's right. What will happen if there is he is not able to close the eye? What can happen?
Exposure keratitis.
Then it can lead to?
Dry.
What is the name? Exposure.
If there is exposure keratitis, is there what it can lead to? What will happen to the cornea?
Corneal ulceration can happen.
So if there is a corneal ulceration is there, what can happen? How does the ulcer heal?
I don't know, sir.
It will either heal by fibrosis, so his cornea will become
sir. Couldn't hear you, sir.
Okay, I think there may be some net connectivity problem. Okay, we'll come back to it, sir, later. So this is what is your history. Comorbidities are important. Rule out any, you know, the you are going to operate on this patient. So diabetes, hypertension, coronary arterial disease, etc. Right? You can change the slide, sir. Dr. Preeti, just for the sake of academic interest, what are the other problems mumps can give rise to other than peritonitis?
Orchitis, sensory neural deafness.
Deafness.
Yes, sir.
What else?
Thyroiditis, pancreatitis, arthritis.
Mumps causing thyroiditis? I do not know. Pancreatitis, definitely.
Pancreatitis, arthritis.
So mainly peritonitis, pancreatitis, and orchitis. These are the main, not that it cannot give rise to other things. Rarely it is possible. So patient had mumps and treated 50 years back. So that's what, at the age of 50, right? So mixed diet, anything related to smoking and alcohol in your case? What else?
He is a non-smoker and non-alcoholic.
Why did you ask that smoking history here?
Smoking can predispose to Warthin's tumor, sir.
So there is an association between the
smoking association.
Yes, sir. Punctual, long years. So that gives again importance of dryness in the oral cavity, mouth. And you need to examine the oral cavity properly for any submucous fibrosis, etc. You will get more marks if you mention like that because he's a puncturer, right? He's a puncturer. Yes, so yes, in a patient, you have got one chance to examine his oral cavity has come to you along with this swelling. So please make a note of that in the oral cavity, all the details, right? Sir has come back, sir.
Mobile mode today.
I think sir has challenge with the internet. He's trying to connect with some other device.
Karnagaran sir, any questions?
Sir, please unmute yourself.
Jagana sir, isn't the mobile thing I see?
We can go ahead, sir.
Please go ahead, sir.
Preeti, yeah. What is the relevance of this? The no history of head and neck cancers in the family. What is that you would like to ask? Hello,
sir.
Yes, please.
We did ask for this family history. Sir is asking.
Sir, if any malignancy is suspected.
No. What we would like to know is, do you think these are all genetically transmitted like any other disease are suspecting, or is it some regions are common for certain disease like, Malaysia and all, you get more of a nasopharyngeal carcinomas with the, that side. So is that way you want to rule out or simply you ask that question? Okay, you want to rule out any family members, brothers or sisters, somebody.
Sir,
All right. So at the end of this, what is your diagnosis? What did you suspect? History wise.
A malignant tumor arising from the right parotid gland.
Okay, I have not seen, only you have seen the case. So probably location might have made you to give a diagnosis, location. Otherwise, I would have thought of metastasis of unknown origin because of his age and weight loss. 63-year-old patient, short duration, rapidly growing, weight loss is there. So I will think of
that. No, sir. No weight loss is there, sir. No history of weight loss.
Sorry, I might have
missed. No history of weight loss.
All right. You thought of parotid. Fine, accepted. Second diagnosis, you also should tell lymph nodal swelling. Okay? Right?
Is malignant more common or benign more common in the parotid?
Benign is more common, sir.
You straight away went into malignancy. From the history-wise, 1 month duration... You noticed it for 1 month, isn't it? The patient noticed it.
Yes, sir.
With that onward, yes, you sir. No patient nerve involvement. You said no, there is so no.
One day.
You straight away went in for a new.
Sir, with the history alone. Sir.
The history alone. Okay, we'll go for the. Karnakar, sir, can we go for the clinical examination?
Yes.
A general examination. Patient is examined in a well-lit room. After obtaining verbal consent, he is conscious and oriented. His BMI is 21.1 kilogram per meter square. Karnofsky performance status is 90%. He had no pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing or pedal edema. No generalized lymphadenopathy. Skull and spine examinations normal. Vitals-wise, his pulse is 78 beats per minute. Blood pressure is 130-90 millimeters of mercury. Respiratory rate is 14 per minute and he's afebrile.
This is the patient. Can you go to the next slide, sir? I'm sharing this slide, sir. Shall I go to the next slide?
Yes. So I just want to bring, doesn't matter, we had a discussion, but one look of this will tell. Because you said it is below the ear lobule, we asked you as a lymph node as a possibility. Now, if you see this, one look will tell you it is not lymph node. Anyway, it doesn't matter. Go ahead.
Regional examination, inspection, facial symmetry is normal. A solitary ovoid swelling of size 5x4 cm is visible behind, below and just anterior to the right ear, extending 5 cm below the mastoid process, 3 cm below and anterior to the right ear lobule. No obvious elevation of right ear lobule noted. Retromandibular groove obliterated. Surface appears to be smooth. Borders are well defined. Skin over the swelling appears to be normal. Contralateral side appears to be normal. No other visible swellings in the neck. On palpation, there is no local rise of temperature. Swelling is non-tender. Confirming the inspectory findings, a solitary ovoid swelling of size 4x3 cm, extending vertically 4 cm downwards from the tip of the mastoid process, inferior border 3 cm below the tragal cartilage, anterior border 2 cm anterior to the tragal cartilage. Surface is lobulated, margins are well defined, firm in consistency, curtain sign is positive, swelling is freely mobile over the masseter. On masseter contraction test, swelling appeared to be more prominent and on opening the mouth, swelling appeared to be less prominent. Skin over the swelling is pinchable. Examination of facial nerve, wrinkling of forehead, closing the eyelids, whistling movement, frowning, clenching, grimacing, all are normal. Bilateral nasolabial fold symmetrical, no deviation of angle of mouth. On oral cavity examination, opening of the mouth is adequate. Articulation of temporomandibular joint appears to be normal. Tobacco stains present in all tooth. Uvula appears to be midline. Opening of the parotid duct normal. There was no pus or bloody discharge noted. There was no redness or impacted calculi. Tonsillar fossa appears to be normal. Palpation of the parotid duct is normal. examination of neck, no cervical lymphadenopathy, cervical spine examination normal. A systemic examination, cardiovascular system, first and heart sound, first and second heart sounds heard normally, no murmurs were heard. Respiratory system, normal vesicular breath sounds, per abdomen, no palpable mass or no organomegaly. Summarizing my history and examination, 63-year-old gentleman came with complaints of swelling behind and in front of the right ear for 1 month, with history of pain in the swelling while chewing the food for 5 days, with no recent onset fever or sudden increase in size of the swelling. Patient does not have any history suggestive of facial nerve involvement. On examination, there is a swelling in the region of right parotid of size 4x3 cm, non-tender, firm, lies deep to parotid fascia and superficial to the masseter, positive Curtin sign, which is free from skin and underlying structures, and facial nerve is intact. My differential diagnosis would be a benign tumor of the right parotid gland, most likely pleomorphic adenoma without facial nerve palsy.
Priti,
sir?
Pleomorphic adenoma is a pathological diagnosis. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Pleomorphic adenoma is a pathological diagnosis.
Okay.
What could be your diagnosis? It should be mixed parotid tumor.
Mixed parotid.
It should be mixed parotid tumor rather than pleomorphic adenoma.
Okay.
Okay,
sir. Okay, sir.
Okay. So you said it is a benign tumor. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
What are the points to say this tumor is not malignant?
Patient had no history of weight loss. There was no history suggestive of facial nerve involvement. On examination, facial symmetry maintained. Surface appears to be smooth. No cervical lymphadenopathy.
Good, very good. Go ahead.
Consistency, fixity.
Go ahead. No trismus. Already you have mentioned there is no trismus. There is no involvement of the temporomandibular joint.
No dismus.
And there is one point in favor of malignancy. What is that point?
That is the duration and the pain.
Yeah. Pain, apart from that, the duration, the patient should have a very short duration in case of malignancy, or a long, the patient with a long history with sudden increase in size. Both are points, I mean, history in favor of malignancy. Apart from these points, there are no points in favor of malignancy. So that there is a high chance that it may be a benign tumor. And your diagnosis must be mixed parotid tumor rather than a pleomorphic adenoma. What is adenolymphoma?
It is Warden's.
What way, clinically, can you diagnose a Warden's tumor? You can say Warden's rather than adenolymphoma.
Yes. Okay, sir. He's a 60-year-old male predominance. The tumor has male predominance.
Smoking history?
Smoking, there is no smoking history, sir.
Usually not bilateral, only 10-20%.
Only 10%.
20% of the times it is bilateral. Apart from that, Warthin's occurs more often in the lower pole of the parotid.
Lower pole of the parotid.
Lower pole of the parotid gland. Okay. It has got a propensity towards the lower pole of the parotid gland. What is the other name for Warthin's tumor? A full complete name.
Papillary cystadenoma lymphomatosum.
Papillary cystadenoma lymphomatosum. Yes. Go ahead.
Priti, sir, Sinai sir said, could this be a lymph node? Now, how do you differentiate whether it's a lymph node or a parotid? The history-wise, Sinai sir said, could it be a lymph node? I say it's a preauricular huge lymph node. What made you to, okay, another way is tell me why this swelling is respiratory. From all your clinical inspection, palpation findings, what are the points to say that the swelling is a parotid swelling?
Sir, it lies in the zone of parotid, sir, in the boundaries of parotid.
Yes.
Parotid region is intersection of two horizontal. It is a region. It is in the region of parotid.
Number two. What is this one? This, what does it lift?
Sir, here in this patient, and it is not obvious, sir. The elevation of the right ear lobule was not obvious, sir. So right. Retromandibular groove is obliterated, sir.
Great.
So what your answer should be that, sir, lymph nodes will not go behind like that, you know, as a continuous swelling. You see that? So just for a completion of discussion, what are the lymph nodes you get behind the ear? Can you tell me? What are the lymph nodes you get behind the ear? Can you name? Yes, correct.
Post-auricular lymph nodes.
And anything else behind the ear means backside, somewhere there?
Suboccipital.
Do you know conditions where you get this lymph nodes enlargement?
In seborrheic dermatitis.
That is any scalp lesion, any can have, but any important tumor or a cancer or a something like that. So non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Okay, they are all horizontal group of nodes. Here, suboccipital, you know, post-auricular, pre-auricular here, pre-auricular in your picture. In front, so all the typically external, you know, they are called as outer Waldeyer's ring, like, you know, all those horizontal group of nodes you can get in cases of a non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, whereas Hodgkin's will not come like that, different layers, they form some kind of a bunch, you know, bunch of grapes or like that. Anyway, the initially when we have not seen the picture, I asked you that question. Now once the picture is seen, that is out of question. Now you have to only say this is parotid tumor. And in that parotid, what I think just now we had a discussion, what is that you would like to give? Why it's called a mixed tumor?
It has both epithelial and mesothelial components.
And why it's called as pleomorphic? Like same explanation, anything you can add to that answer which you gave just now? Mixed only, yes?
More than one type of cell is present.
So, myoepithelial cells. Mucoid, like, you know, cartilage, like.
Silent material.
Yes, so all that give rise to the appearance. So that's why it's called a pleomorphic adenoma, also called a mucoid tumor, right? One other question, other than the, when do you suspect malignancy? Yes, sir has asked you all that question, mainly facial nerve. Also, you should remember to examine for the mastoid tenderness. Mastoid tenderness. Can you tell me why? Can you tell me why? Mastoid tenderness. Here, backside. In addition to the swelling, any which tumor of the parotid can spread to the bones through some. Yes, come on, try. Yes, perineural invasion. You heard of that?
Yes, sir.
Which malignancy? It's one of the rapidly growing tumors of the parotid. What is that? Adenoid cystic carcinoma. It can go along the nerve sheath, actually, along the nerve sheath, and distant bones also can get affected. So in and around the parotid region, definitely not in this patient. You said so freely mobile swelling. That's what you have written there, no? So intensity is so much present, firm swelling, skin is free, masseter is not involved, no other swelling. So obviously, we need to accept a benign as a diagnosis in this patient as a possible. Did you examine the for deep lobe enlargement?
Yes, sir. On oral cavity inspection, tonsillar fossa appears to be normal. It was not medialized, sir.
I agree. inspection, but also make up a point to palpate the area also. In case if the examiner asks you, you should know where you keep your palpation fingers, outside and inside. Where do you keep outside?
Sir, outside behind the posterior border of the ramus of the mandible, inside in the lateral pharyngeal wall.
How does the tumor from the parotid reach that area, parapharyngeal area? How does this tumor go there?
Between mastoid and mandible.
No, I know. Any area, you know, it has to go through some kind of a space, no? It has to go through some kind of a space. That's how it's called as stylomandibular tunnel of Patty. You know Patty? Heard of the name Patty?
Yes, sir.
Where do you get Patty in parotid?
Facio venous plane of Patty.
A man who described this. So that is what the deep lobe tumors can go through that tunnel and form another swelling like a dumbbell type, you know, dumbbell. So that's why that is a deep lobe tumors. So you need to mention that. And in the oral cavity, you need to mention the parotid duct opening and see for any erythema, pus coming, or any calculi. I know that it is
not common.
Okay. They are, you know, like concretions, like, you know, small particles like thing, still possible here. Okay, right.
In the oral cavity examination, I mentioned all that, sir. Parotid.
No, sir, didn't see probably, no problem. See, in this photo, you can see the third photo shows there's typical lifting of the yellow bill. And how do you look for the retromandibular groove obliteration? Prithi? You should stand behind the patient and see both sides for retromandibular groove obliteration. Okay.
Yes, sir.
In this patient, the third photograph shows you that the right ear lobe is lifted. Now, how do you look for the plane of the swelling before we go for the final? Jekana sir is coming. Plane of the swelling, how it is deep to the deep fascia?
Patient is asked to clench his teeth. Over the masseter, contracted masseter, swelling appeared to be more prominent. It shows that it is superficial to the masseter.
How it is deep to the deep fascia, what will you do? We're stretching up.
When patient is asked to open the mouth, the swelling became less prominent as it is deep to the parotid fascia.
It is one point which differentiates a small parotid swelling from a preauricular lymph node. Okay. Are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir.
Right. So, Ajay Khanna sir has joined. What is this curtain sign?
When the swelling is pushed upwards, it cannot go beyond the zygomatic arch. It cannot be pushed beyond the zygomatic arch.
Reason being,
parotid is invested between the superficial and the deep lamina of investing layer of deep cervical fascia. And the superficial fascia getting attached to the zygomatic arch, and deep lamina gets attached to the tympanic plate and the styloid process. It is in a closed compartment so that it cannot be moved beyond the zygomatic arch.
Shanoi sir, can you go for the...
Yes, sir. We can actually go to the diagnosis is clear.
How will you proceed further, ma?
Sir, I'm not able to get the question, sir. Sorry, sir.
How will you proceed with this patient? How will you go along and investigate and treat the patient?
So, just for a completion sake of clinical examination, Dr. Prithi, you should be in the university examination. First, you should anatomically say why do you say parotid. Already, most of the points you have clarified. Pathologically, yes. What are the diagnoses? Most common swelling is a pleomorphic adenoma, so you do it. Suppose if this is a hard swelling, what are the diagnoses you can offer? If it is hard, parotid tumor.
Mucoepidermoid carcinoma.
So it is mucoepidermoid carcinoma is another possibility if it is hard tumor. So, and if it, as I mentioned, very rapidly growing tumor, ulceration sometimes, then you need to think of adenoid cystic carcinoma. But remember, don't try to offer that histological diagnosis. You say malignant parotid tumor, okay?
Yes, sir.
And let the examiner ask you, give a chance, then you can come out with these possibilities, okay? And okay. As Dr. Khanna sir has mentioned in the beginning, when both parotid glands are enlarged, you may have to think of adenolymphoma or maybe a lymphoma itself, okay? Right, that has been asked to you. So anatomically, then pathologically. And all case of parotid, you need to also mention examination for other salivary gland. I'm not sure whether I heard or not. You need to mention submandibular salivary gland. Is it enlarged or not enlarged? Okay?
Okay, sir.
You need to mention because not only opposite parotid, but because there are sometimes you get all this common. And in the abdomen, again, as I mentioned in the first time, especially in women, instead of trying to say no mass palpables, mention splenomegaly here. Okay? Why? Why splenomegaly? Specifically, I mentioned to you autoimmune problems, right? Autoimmune. So always remember to mention that, right? Diagnosis is pleomorphic adenoma. How do you go ahead?
As an extension of my clinical examination, I would like to do an ultrasound to confirm whether it is the swelling is arising from the region of parotid, to know the status of lymph nodes, involvement of deep flow.
Do you want to do ultrasound in this patient? What information it is going to give you?
Sir, status of the deep flow, status of the lymph nodes.
How will you know on ultrasound that there is a deep lobe is there?
Deep lobe, it is not a good investigation, Dr. Preeti. Think.
I think in this, if you really want to do the ultrasound, then it is only for the lymph nodes which are there. You can see
neck.
For the other lymph nodes which are there in the neck. But I do not think that you can get any idea in the parotid itself about the ultrasound. Okay, it's not like abdominal ultrasound where you want to know that. Clinically, we know it's a parotid gland which is there. Okay. So ultrasound is not going to add anything extra here in this patient.
Yes, sir.
Okay. What next investigation you want to do?
CT.
When do you do a CT scan in a patient with a parotid mass? The indications of carrying out a CT scan.
Sir, again, to know the status of the lymph node, deep lobe involvement, to know the deep lobe involvement, suspect, if you suspect any neural spread, facial nerve,
yes, CT scan, the first indication is to know about the deep lobe status. What is happening on deep lobe. That you can see on the CT scan. You know, much
rather
than the lymph, yeah, and then the lymph nodes which are there. Now, will you like to do the FNAC in this patient or not? What do you think?
Yes, sir. We can do ultrasound guided FNAC, sir.
Now, your diagnosis is a patient with a parotid adenoma, is it? Mixed parotid tumor?
Mixed parotid tumor, sir.
And you are not thinking that the deep lobe is involved?
Yes, sir.
So if the deep lobe is not involved and it is only limited to the superficial lobe only, then what is the minimal surgery you are going to do?
Superficial parotidectomy.
So when you are going to do a superficial parotidectomy, then why you want to do the FNAC?
To rule out malignancy.
Are you suspecting malignancy in this patient?
No, sir.
So I think that's a little debate which is there, that whether we should really go for the
FNAC of the, because the minimal surgery which is being done is the superficial pedrectomy. Okay, when you're doing the superficial pedrectomy, then probably there is no need for carrying out the FNAC. But the other school thinks that probably to think about whether it's malignancy or not, you may go for the FNAC. So there's a big debate about that. Dr. Rajgopal, what do you say about that?
Sir, I think I fully agree with you, sir. But what we teach is, adding on to this, no harm in doing FNAC. So today everybody is talking about ultrasound-guided FNAC. So no harm in doing, but as you rightly put it, slow-growing, these tumors are observed. Like this. So anyway, correct, sir. Just want to add whatever if the examiner asked you, CT scan, sir has already told a definite indication is deep lobe tumor, lymph node, extraglandular spread for facial nerve, which is better investigation?
MRI, sir.
So I think you mentioned somewhere facial nerve. So to know that real plane, nerve infiltration and infratemporal fossa, infratemporal fossa, large ones, skull base. So there's a protocol also for this, CT protocol and even MRI specifically to look for these lesions. Then MRI is indicated. Okay.
Sir, Rajgopal, sir, I'm Dr. Sihari speaking.
Sir, please.
Deep lobe, clinically, can you inspect the oral cavity and suggest the deep lobe involvement?
Yes, sir.
So clinically, in her presentation, she has not told about the in the oral cavity examination.
I've mentioned, sir. About
it. Sir, she has mentioned, sir. I asked that question. If there is a real significant shift, you can make out by inspection. She has mentioned, sir, actually.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you.
Yeah. So, Dr. Karunakaran, sir, any questions, sir, from your side?
Let me ask my questions during the treatment part.
Yes, sir. We have come to, I think we have reached now. So, yeah, Preeti, I think now you want to, what do you want to do? Okay, I'll give the situation for you. You have done ultrasound FNAC. It has reported as pleomorphic adenoma. That's it. Okay, CT has been done. No deep lobe enlargement. Over. No facial nerve infiltrated. No lymph nodes. Sir, please take over.
Sir, Preeti? Yes, sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
What other investigations you want to do before subjecting the patient for surgery? You want to add any investigation? If you suspect you are doing an MRI to confirm whether the deep lobe is involved or not, okay. Let us find this case, the deep lobe is involved or not. You got slides of the investigation?
No, sir.
Am I audible?
Sir, your voice is breaking, sir.
You got your slides? My voice is breaking.
Yes, sir.
Do you have the slide mentioning the results of the investigation?
Not able to hear, sir.
Oh, God.
Okay, Preeti, tell your, what are you going to do for this patient?
Sir, in this patient, I would like to do superficial parotidectomy.
Have you counseled your patient or have you given adequate consent to this patient?
Yes, sir. After obtaining the consent and the risk of facial nerve injury during a superficial parotidectomy,
so what are the things you told in your consent?
Sir, injury to the facial nerve should be mentioned, sir.
No, but chance of injury to the patient will not understand that what is injury to the facial nerve.
Facial palsy, paralysis.
So what did you explain to the patient?
You might have a difficulty in closure of your eyelids. You might have deviation of your angle of mouth. Difficulty in pushing the food from your mouth to the food pipe.
So one you told about the one you told about the facial nerve. So various components of the facial nerve. Any other counseling you told this patient? Specific counseling? Any other special problem which can occur after your superficial parotidectomy apart from the facial paralysis?
Frey syndrome, sir.
So did you explain about the Frey syndrome to this patient or patient party?
I should explain, sir.
What you will explain in that?
When you are eating the food, you might get increased sweating over the region of the parotid where the surgery has happened. You might have increased sweating in the area.
So at least these two important complications has to be explained before you undergo further surgery. Okay. Now, you are taking your patient on the table.
Okay, sir.
Yes. What you will do now? Patient is on the operation table now.
Okay, sir. Hmm. Sir, under general anesthesia, patient is positioned in with the sandbag under the shoulder, head ring below the head with 15 degree elevation. Cleaning and draping is done away that the angle of the mouth and nasolabial fold should be visible.
Mm-hmm. What about the eyes?
And the ipsilateral eyes and head is tilted to the opposite side of the operation side.
If you are working at the best center, what else you will do before you put the incision? You are working at the best center.
Facial nerve stimulator.
How do you put the facial nerve stimulators? Where do you put them? Okay, there are multiple needles are there, needle probes are there. So you have to put in the different muscles which are there, like orbicularis oris, orbicularis oculi. Okay, so you have to put this multiple needle probes in that, and then it is connected to the stimulator there. Okay. If you are working in a good center, all the parotid surgery is done under the nerve control. Right. Then what you will do after this? You are prepared now.
Okay, sir.
Then what will do?
I will mark the incision. I will mark the incision, sir.
Mark the incision. How will you mark the incision? A classical superficial parotid.
A preauricular mastoid and cervical incision, sir. It is a S-shaped incision.
From where you will start?
Just in front of the tragal cartilage, sir, curving around the ear lobule, reaching the mastoid and over the anterior border of the upper one-third of the sternocleidomastoid muscle.
And what precaution you will take when you are making the cervical incision? How far below you will be the ramus of the mandible? What nerve can come in that area?
A marginal mandibular nerve.
So if you want to prevent
how the great is that nerve? How great is that nerve?
Why? What is important in preserving? Sir is asking. Karnagaran sir is asking why? What the marginal mandibular nerve is great? Why you want to preserve? Sir, you can answer, sir. Karnagaran.
So actually, sir, Ajay Khanna sir is meaning about the greater auricular.
I was asking about the marginal mandibular nerve.
Okay, sir.
Because if you damage the marginal mandibular nerve, what can happen?
Numbness,
so no, there will be motor problem will be there. What will happen to the angle of the oral cavity?
Deviation.
If you damage that nerve, there will be deviation of the deviation angle of the oral cavity. Now, out of these five nerves, you know, these five divisions which are there, if you have to save one division, which division you would like to save?
Temporofacial. Buccal.
No.
See, you want to prefer the eyes or the mouth?
Eyes, the temporal branch.
So which one you will like to save? Name the branch.
Temporofacial, sir.
No, that goes on the upper side, which supplies the orbital oculi.
A clue also, Karnaran, sir. You say the mouth or eyes?
You want to preserve the nerve to the eyes or the mouth? Which one is
it? Eyes.
So you save the zygomatic branch, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. If you have to save one branch, you will save the zygomatic branch. Right? That supplies the eyes. Okay. So you have made incision. What is the name of this incision?
Modified Blair.
Okay. Okay. Then go further now. You have made a skin incision. Then?
I will... deepen the cervical part of the incision first.
How deep that will be?
Subplatysmal.
Why you want to go subplatysmal? What is the purpose of going subplatysmal?
What is the purpose of doing a subplatysmal incision?
Again, the same nerve, okay, which you are discussing. If you remain superficial to that, you will damage that. But if you are deep to the platysma, you can secure that nerve, okay? Then, how far you will make your incision, your flap, how far your flap will go?
Sir, in the cervical region, sir?
No. Yeah, the cervical and in the cheek also.
Cervical mastoid, pre-auricular, just in front of the tragal cortex.
Yes, but I'm asking... You have to now raise the flap there. So how far you will go for raising the flap?
Sir, flap is raised up till the anterior border of the parotid gland, sir.
So what will the landmark there?
Sir, you can answer. Sir, you are muted, sir, please.
Tell the parotid region, then you can answer that, yeah.
Sir?
Tell about the boundaries of the parotid region.
Mes.
What is the anterior boundary of that?
Masseter.
Okay. So, you have to go up to that area, which is just short of the angle of the mouth. and it should go beyond your palpable tumor. Okay, your flap should be going beyond your palpable tumor. Okay, then what next you will do?
Dr. Preeti, have you assisted or have you seen any superficial peritonectomy? First question. Before she answers, sir. That is why. So, sir is probably asking you, after you raise the flap, how do you reach the facial nerve? I think sir wants to know that. So, if you know, please tell. Otherwise, you can, go ahead.
Tell one nerve which comes, What greater, is that nerve which will come? Yeah, greater auricular nerve. Will
come, lies over
the sternocleidomastoid.
Backside.
Okay. Do you know how to identify what are the various points to identify the facial nerve?
Yes, sir. At the junction between bony and cartilaginous part of the external auditory canal.
So it is actually just 1 centimeter inferomedial.
Inferomedial.
What is that pointer called as? It is actually pointer. Either you can say Conley pointer or a triangle pointer. It is actually just showing you like that. But head and neck surgeons or ENT people will dissect it in another way. You know what is that way?
Retrograde.
Tracing the posterior below digastric. That is the easy.
Yes, in the insertion of the posterior belly of the digastric, below which just 30 degree lateral to it, to the insertion of the posterior belly of digastric, we can find the facial nerve there.
When the anatomy is not clear, a large tumor which would have displaced the facial nerve, etc., difficult cases only you follow the retrograde manner. Otherwise, it is never done. Okay. Never done means not easy, commonly done.
This is said by Hamilton only, but he himself was not satisfied with that retrograde. From the buccal bone, he start tracing. But unless you are not able to identify in this way, you have to go for the retrograde. Otherwise, don't say that as your sir said, ask for 2 points. Is there 2 points? Is there any other point? Any artery?
Sir.
Stylomastoid artery.
In the exit of the stylomastoid foramen, just lateral to the stylo, facial nerve lies over the styloid process, sir.
What is Patty's spleen?
Fasciovenous plane of Patty divides the parotid gland into superficial and deep.
Okay. What are the various things in the Patty's spleen?
One is facial nerve, retromandibular vein, and external carotid artery.
Which is superficial, which is deep?
So above the superficial to the facial venous plane of Patty is superficial lobe, below which is deep.
Which is superficial? You said artery or vein?
Nerve is superficial, sir.
The next come?
Nerve, vein, artery.
Ms. Karnavaran said, ask you a question. What is the importance of greater auricular nerve?
A greater auricular nerve
will you preserve
supplies the capsule of the...
Will you preserve or...
It can be divided, sir.
Which anterior branch?
So, what is the anatomical point of the greater auricular nerve? What is that point called?
It like
Herb's point. Herb's point. Then I'll ask a few questions, one after the other. See, why don't you go for an excision of a superficial, parotid tumor? Why you are going for a superficial parotid tumor? What is the reason behind that? We can do an enucleation excision.
Minimal.
We can do an enucleation excision. Why go for a superficial prototype?
Pleomorphic adenoma will have extension beyond the capsule, sir.
Yes.
So, chance of local recurrence after enucleation is there. So, we are going for a superficial parotidectomy.
Yes, that's a good thing. There was a famous saying by one famous surgeon called Vijay Kumar of Kidwai. He used to say, benign behaves less benign and malignant behaves less malignant. Okay. See, here the benign tumor behaves like a malignant tumor. The recurrence is a character of a malignant tumor. Whereas in pleomorphic adenoma, recurrence is very common because of pseudopodia-like projections that goes beyond the capsule that leads to recurrence. That's why we are going for a superficial parotidectomy rather than excision. Yes?
Yes.
Yes. Then you remove the tumor. I mean, you remove the superficial lobe. Can you have a clear cut plane between a superficial lobe and deep lobe in case of parotid?
That is a facio-venous plane of Fardy.
That is a theoretical one. Once you operate, you won't find any plane of cleavage between a superficial and deep lobe of parotid. It's really difficult to dissect. Okay. So one more hypothetical question. This patient is having a deep lobe enlargement. What is your treatment?
Total conservative parotidectomy.
Okay. You want to do a total conservative parotidectomy. What precaution you want to do in this patient if at all you plan for a total conservative parotidectomy? Are you able to catch my point?
No, sir.
See, the one important thing, if at all you want to do a total parotidectomy or total conservative parotidectomy, you have to have a control of the external carotid artery, proximal control of the external carotid artery. Why?
You can answer.
See, actually, sir, Srinivasan, sir, if you want to.
No, you can answer. Please.
See, actually, on the terminal branches of the facial, what is that, external carotid artery, the terminal branches passes through the deep lobe of the parotid and divides finally into the maxillary and superficial temporal branch. So when you operate on the deep lobe, you may injure the distal portion of the external carotid artery. That may lead to torrential bleeding, which we may panic. We could not know how to manage. So if we have a proximal control of the external carotid, we just put a vascular clamp there, suck out and find out the cut end, and we can ligate. So without having a proximal control of the external carotid artery, it's difficult. And the field may be messy when you do a total parotidectomy. So the one important point, if you want to do a total parotidectomy or a total conservative parotidectomy, we should have a proximal control of the external carotid artery. Okay, even you can ligate an external carotid artery, it does not create any major problem, if at all it is needed.
Karna sir, please.
What are the complications once you do it, once you finish your surgery? What are all the complications you expect in a case of parotid surgery?
Parotid fistula, Frey syndrome. Facial numbness, facial nerve palsy.
Yes. Yes, go ahead. You won't have the exact symmetry of your face after a facial. Even with the best among the best surgeries, we may have minimal injury to the facial nerve. So the symmetry may not be as previous to the surgery. So we have to explain. That is one important point. for people like media people and all. So they need have a good symmetrical face. So we have to explain all these things. Very, very important point, medico-legally. Okay. Any other point you want to add?
Find that you have damaged the facial nerve intraoperatively. How will you manage that?
Primary suturing of the nerve can be done, sir.
Provided there is not a big segment loss is there, isn't it?
Yes, so sir.
So when you will require some other type of the surgery intraoperatively apart from doing a primary suturing?
If a part of the facial nerve is dissected or sacrificed, we can have a cable graft of greater auricular nerve, sir, from greater auricular nerve.
So you can take the greater auricular nerve, any other nerve which you can use there?
Sural nerve, hypoglossal nerve.
Now, if it is, you have detected it after the operation, then what you will do? Post-operatively detected, there is a facial nerve injury is there. What you will do?
Muscle transfer or nerve transfer can be.
No, but when you will try that?
No, sir, I don't know, sir.
What are the various types of the nerve injuries which can happen?
Neuropraxia, neurotmesis, axonotmesis.
So, majority of the time, there will be neuropraxia will be there. So, do you require any active surgery for that?
No, sir. We will wait and watch, sir. It will recover in 6 weeks' time, sir.
We'll wait for about 3 months, okay?
3 months.
And majority of the neuropraxia may recover after that. If they do not recover, then you have to think about, are you going for the nerve treatment or you are going for the dynamic treatment or you can go for the adynamic treatment? What are the various types of adynamic treatments which are required? Like there's exposure keratitis is there.
Lateral torsoraphy.
Why you don't do a medial tarsorrhaphy? Why you do a lateral tarsorrhaphy?
Lacrimal ductus.
On the medial lacrimal side, the lacrimal duct.
Lacrimal ductus.
Right. And for the angle of the mouth, what you can do?
Botulinum toxin injection.
Some adynamic procedures.
For angle of the mouth, muscle transfer can be done.
Make the slings there. Okay.
Slings.
Yeah, slings to the temporis muscle which is there so that your angle of the mouth doesn't droop down. It remains static in the upper position, or you can also do a dynamic type of the slings also there. What you do for the Frey syndrome?
Frey syndrome, botulinum toxin injection, sir. Intraoperatively, we can try sternomastoid flap or temporalis flap between the skin and the nerve.
So, first thing, you keep a thick flap.
Thick flap.
You have to put it. Keep a thick flap. If it is not, then you can cover it with the sternocleidomastoid or the temporalis fascia.
Temporalis fascia.
If there's a parotid fistula is there, from where the parotid duct comes, from the superficial or the deep lobe?
A deep lobe, sir.
Parotid duct.
Yes, sir.
Submandibular.
I think we have crossed 9:30, sir. We have one more case.
Right, okay.
Can you give the closing comment, sir? Then we move to the next case.
Okay, there is no doubt that the parotid surgery is the surgery of the facial nerve, isn't it? You have to be very careful about that, and then only you can succeed in carrying out the carotid surgery. Okay, so you have to be very careful about the nerves there. And there are main three problems which you have discussed is the facial paralysis, which is there. Second is the face syndrome, and third is the parotid fistula. You know? These are three problems which are there. All these three things initially are always treated based on the conservative treatment. And later only, after about 3 to 6 months, you take some active treatment for the treatment of all these three conditions. Okay, thank you.
Preeti, just only one word of, if this is confined only to the lower pole of the parotid, can you suggest any other parotidectomy for this patient? It's only lower pole. You understood my question?
Yes, sir.
So my hint is to you is, can you avoid dissecting the facial nerve? That is the whole idea of asking this question. What? You understood my question?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I will ask you straight away. All benign parotid tumors like pleomorphic, we do superficial parotidectomy. No doubt about this. But if there is a lesion in the lower pole, where small lesions, you can do what is called an adequate parotidectomy. This is now accepted word also, terminology. Bailey and Love also has given. The idea is to avoid the injury to the facial nerve morbidity. So adequate parotidectomy, where you just need to take about a centimeter of the additional tissue of the parotid. So incision, you may put the same incision, but you don't have to dissect the facial nerve. That is what is the meaning of the adequate. And I think one more word you should know, called extracapsular parotidectomy. Extracapsular parotidectomy. You go outside the capsule by putting a cruciate incision and deliver the this one. These are the few things they may ask you as a recent advance for a parotidectomy. You should know. That's all from my side, Dr. Kanak.
Preeti, you would like to ask any doubts to be clarified with the senior faculty here?
No, sir.
Any, you've been reading about the case, you have any questions or any ominous things which you are not very clear?
Quick recollect of Preeti of the five F's for the complication. You know, one is the most important is the flap necrosis. You know, that is why we ask, you know, that lazy S or whatever you can call it as. Flap necrosis. Then fluid, nothing but seroma collection. Then, of course, facial nerve, Prey syndrome, right? Heard of that, no? Prey syndrome.
Yes, sir.
Facial nerve palsy and salivary fistula. Salivary fistula. These are the important five complications. Yes. Any questions are there?